Thank you all for being here tonight as we begin our Confronting Islamophobia speaker series with our 2017 Manekin-Clark Lecturer, Dr. Anver Emon. The Institute for Islamic, Christian, and Jewish Studies was founded 30 years ago based on the following premise: fear, ignorance, and contempt that exists between people with different beliefs cannot be left unchecked, but requires action. We can, and indeed we must, work to reduce prejudice in our communities. At the ICJS, our work has never been more urgent. As you well know, we are challenged by violent and dangerous levels of anti-Semitism and Islamophobia in America. Jewish community centers and schools are receiving bomb threats, and Jewish cemeteries are being desecrated. Muslims, and those perceived to be Muslim, are being physically attacked and killed. Mosques are being burned. The ICJS remains vigilant in our efforts to combat anti-Semitism, and tonight we begin the work of confronting Islamophobia in our city, in our state, and in our country. What do we do? How does the Institute for Islamic, Christian, and Jewish Studies as an organization work to challenge prejudices, fear, and violence? We firmly believe that two ingredients are necessary to build resilient interreligious networks. The first is increased knowledge, and the second is real friendships. Tonight's Manekin-Clark Lecture reminds us that the ICJS was forged on the basis of friendships that not so long ago would have been unimaginable in Baltimore. Bernie Manekin, one of the founding Jewish trustees of the ICJS, was a man who became entangled in the lives of those he came to know and love, and Bernie's affections were not limited by religious affiliation. Jim Clark, a Presbyterian mensch known by many of you, was a builder who wanted to change the inner as well as the outer landscape of urban America. Jim was one of those people who came into Bernie's orbit, and the gravitational pull of Bernie's personality was irresistible. A lifelong friendship was forged, and while neither Bernie nor Jim are with us on Earth, the Manekin-Clark Lecture bears witness to their deep and resilient relationship. The Manekin-Clark Lecture is an expression of Bernie and Jim's belief that we belong to one another, despite our religious differences. The Baltimoreans of all faiths can challenge one another to live in ways that deepen our respective commitments and strengthen our community. While I did not have the privilege to know either man, I trust that both would have been among the first to extend the hand of friendship to their Muslim neighbors in this critical hour. We are fortunate to have with us a good representation of Jim and Bernie's families, and I ask them to stand and be recognized as we honor the power of friendship across religious difference to be a force for good in our community. I conclude my introduction by recognizing the ICJS sponsors who made the Confronting Islamophobia series possible. Institutional friendships and community partnerships are pivotal to a healthy city and community. It is with deep gratitude that I recognize the ACLU of Maryland, the Howard County Muslim Council, the Maryland Humanities Council, and WYPR. It is now my distinct pleasure to invite my friend and colleague, Dr. Homera Ziad, the ICJS Scholar of Islam, to the podium. Thank you.
It is an immense pleasure to introduce Dr. Anver Emon tonight. Dr. Emon is an internationally recognized expert on Islamic law and professor and Canada Research Chair in Religion, Pluralism, and the Rule of Law at the University of Toronto's Faculty of Law. He has multiple degrees, but the two that I will talk about are a doctorate in law from Yale and a doctorate in history from UCLA. With these qualifications, Dr. Emon is uniquely poised to explore the long and rich history of the Islamic tradition and its implications for contemporary questions of governance and the rule of law. He approaches Islamic law as both a historical tradition and as a vehicle of critique, through which he questions common assumptions of what counts as law and legal rationality, as well as the often triumphalist narrative of a liberal legal order. He works broadly in the fields of law and religion, legal history, and legal philosophy, and he works across multiple legal traditions, including Jewish law, in his research and teaching. He has many publications, but the few that I would like to share are the Religious Pluralism and Islamic Law, Islamic and Jewish Legal Reasoning, Encountering Our Legal Other, and Islamic Law and International Human Rights Law, Searching for Common Ground. He is also co-editor and a founder, actually, and general editor of the Oxford Islamic Legal Studies series. And in 2014, he was named a Guggenheim Fellow in the field of law. Dr. Emon, and as we've got to know him more today, is a committed public intellectual in that he brings his deep scholarly grounding to consultations for governments, nonprofits, and legal advocacy groups across the world. And he has also worked on high school curricula. He's really committed to trying to translate the depth of his scholarship into the public square. And so, of course, there he jives really well with the work that we do. He is also a lovely human being, as I've gotten to know today. He's a pleasure to work with as we've gone back and forth and trying to figure out what he's going to talk about and how he's going to do it. He's really been a pleasure to work with. And he gets what we want to do as an organization. Personally, it's a pleasure for me to have him here because Anver and I overlapped for several years in New Haven. We were both at Yale at the same time. We shared multiple friends, and we heard about each other all the time. We never met, ever. I don't know how that happened. So for me, this is long overdue, and it has been a pleasure. So thank you, Anver.
I want to begin first by thanking the Institute for Islamic, Jewish, and Christian Studies for inviting me to be the Manekin-Clark Lecturer for 2017. I've been privileged to have had the chance to work with the scholars of the ICJ the last few months, thinking about what this talk could be and how it should morph as current events have morphed as well. And it's been a real pleasure to work with them. The collaborative spirit has been generative for me, and I hope it's been useful for them. And again, the date I've had with them on the premises with the community leaders earlier today has been a real tremendous bonus for me. I want to preface the substantive part of this talk, excuse me, by admitting something to you. This has been, I would say, one of the hardest talks I've ever had to come up with. As an academic, and in particular as a historian of the pre-modern Islamic world, I've often taken great pleasure in bringing to life all too exoticized artifacts from the past, often to interrogate our assumptions about reason, about law, about governance, and regulation. I've studied Islamic law as a historian, but I teach it as a law professor in a Canadian context, where my students are studying to be Canadian lawyers. And so I position the Islamic, and here I put it in quotes, as a provincializing technique to show the contours of what counts as law in Canada, and thereby give students a better appreciation not only of the boundaries of their legal system, but also of its hidden coercive, if not exclusionary, tendencies. Here's an example from Arizona in 2011 of one of those sort of coercive exclusionary rules regarding banning Sharia. I find it particularly humorous. This is the 2011 Arizona bill that sought to ban religious law from judicial analysis. It's funny in my mind because of the scope of the prohibition. If you take a look at part of it, Section A is about a court not implementing religious sectarian law, and then defining religious sectarian law in section F3 as including Sharia law, canon law, halakha, and karma. Whoever wants to mess with karma? Seems like a bad idea. But lately, it's been hard. It's hard to say much at all about the Islamic. Whatever my expertise may be about the Islamic, I can't quite tell if it matters in an era where facts don't matter generally, and when age-old prejudices and stereotypes about the Muslim and the Islamic become once more popularized as the latest truisms. But it's also been hard to talk about, to talk for another reason, a more personal one that requires me to speak autobiographically for a moment, which I never do, which is partially why this is a hard talk, but I think it's important nonetheless. I speak from a position of privilege. I'm a tenured professor of law at a globally respected institution in a country that is economically developed and in a city that offers anything anyone would want, most importantly for me, peace, security, and the means for me and my family. I'm the eldest son of Muslim immigrants from India who immigrated to the US in the 1960s, moving from one status as minorities in a majority Hindu state to another status as minorities in a popularly Christian state. They've only known what it means to be a minority, and it is perhaps no surprise for those familiar with immigrant narratives that they instilled in me and my sister adaptive techniques that verged at times on the assimilative, on the assumption that we would socially advance on the basis of a presumed rags to riches Hans Christian Andersen image of American meritocracy. I'm also an immigrant to Canada. As an American, I now live there. And as such, I find myself participating in the project of settler colonialism against Canada's indigenous peoples who are, given a historical error, mistakenly identified as Indians. Columbus came for my people, but got them instead. Eventually, they found us, so I suppose it was all really a matter of time. But I constantly find it odd to self-identify as Indian in a context in which that term is not only a European historical mistake, but also has been what we might call a productive mistake, at least productive for Canadian sovereignty, a mistake that has informed policies of demarcation, derision, and domination, whereas in my context, it's informed an anti-colonial politics and continues to inform a proud nationalism. And lastly, I come to the study of Islam and Islamic law not merely out of professional curiosity, but out of a personal set of commitments. As such, I research and write in a university setting about a tradition that is my own, when at the same time, the field of Islamic studies in which I'm included would have once accused me of being incapable of objectivity. When at the same time, the study of Islam in the university is seen by Muslim communities here and abroad as a secular project, by which apparently implicates me in the secular project. When at the same time, my own critical stance on the Islamic puts me in opposition in the Muslim majority, puts me in opposition, tension, and deep argument with a clerical establishment in the Muslim majority world that defines Islam for their populace. Indeed, I've been yelled at by sheikhs and clerics in the Muslim world more times than I can remember. And when at the same time, since 9/11, and especially since 2016, I've increasingly found myself lumped together with violent terrorists who claim to act in the name of a faith tradition that I both study professionally and identify with personally. So with all that going on in the background, it's hard to know what to say, where to start, and whether it's worth it. Shortly after President Trump's inauguration, I found myself silent, and as I struggled with that silence, I took comfort in the compassionate words of a friend of mine, a colleague at the law faculty, David Schneiderman, who recounted to me the silence of his parents who had survived the Holocaust. I listened carefully to the words of the former Assembly of First Nations chief, Phil Fontaine, who recounted the silence among survivors of Canada's residential schools program that stole children from their Indian parents to educate the Indian out of them. But if for those communities silence was a survival technique, it was rather self-indulgent, if not shameful for me, to remain silent as if I needed to do so to survive like members of those communities needed. While no one people or community has a monopoly on suffering, I enjoy far too much liberty, freedom, and privilege to think that I need to be silent to survive. So if silence was not an option, what to say? That's when I read the Ninth Circuit's decision on the motion to stay the Federal District Court's temporary restraining order on Trump's executive order, known popularly as the Muslim ban. What struck me most profoundly was why the court found the states of Washington and Minnesota to have standing. Anyone know what it was? Anyone who wasn't at the earlier reception specifically? where I gave it away. The reason that, that Washington and Minnesota could bring the suit at all was because of the public university. To establish standing, a party must show that it has suffered a concrete and particularized injury that either that is either actual or imminent, that the injury is fairly traceable to the defendant, and that it is likely that a favorable decision will redress that injury, so said the court. And in the case of the states of Washington and Minnesota, the injury they suffered had everything to do with the growth, transmission, and mobility associated with ideas in the university. The Ninth Circuit wrote, "The states argue that the executive order causes a concrete and particularized injury to their public universities. Specifically, the states allege that the teaching and research missions of the university are harmed by the executive order's effect on their faculty and students who are nationals of the seven affected countries," end quote. In this case, the universities of Minnesota and Washington were suffering from the imposition on students and faculty who could no longer come to the two universities because of their countries of origin. On technical legal grounds, the states were able to align the interests of these third-party individuals as if it were the state's own. It's an important legal move that empowers the states on behalf of those who perhaps were not so empowered. But symbolically, and certainly for me, at a time when fake news informed an election outcome, when truth and accuracy are of little relevance to a politics of resentment, it's important that harm to the university was the basis by which the executive order was suspended by the courts. So despite my earlier uncertainty about what to say, it's the privilege of both being a product of the academy and a member of the academy that brings me here today. My aim today is to draw upon the spirit of the university as an incubator of ideas, perspectives, and approaches, some of them really wrong-headed too, to reflect broadly and deeply about our current state of affairs, even though the relevance of what I discuss today may not be immediately obvious. Indeed, when Abraham Flexner extolled the usefulness of useless knowledge back in 1939, he meant to emphasize how the pursuit of knowledge cannot be valued through utilitarian calculations of returns on investment. So if you're left at the end of this talk confused at what to do, I say perfect. I'm not here to urge you to do anything. There are enough people doing things, saying things, tweeting things. For a few weeks, I tried to follow it all and only found myself spinning with a world that seemed to spin out of control. So today, I'm here standing still with you. I do so with the aim of exploring a set of ideas with you in the hopes of deepening understanding, because that is my antidote to a post-truth world. And it's an antidote that those of us in the academy must assume responsibility for administering. So today I want to present an argument with a basic thesis and a corollary. The argument, the thesis, the invocation of the Muslim and the Islamic today has everything to do with how we envision and fashion not only what the state is for, but also for whom. The corollary. As a legal historian, my claim is that the law offers one, but nonetheless a powerful sight by which we can identify the what and the whom for which the state is fashioned. But I'm getting a bit ahead of myself here. Let me back up a bit and give some parallel accounts that will both support and also situate my argument. To be clear, I'm not suggesting that for all times and all places, the Islamic and the Muslim have been implicated in the construction of the state. I am arguing instead that rather than seeing the Muslim and the Islamic as only objects of analysis, as things to be assessed and analyzed, a there that's there, which they are too, and I'd be happy to have that conversation in the Q&A, instead I want to offer them here as constructs, as social constructs that are doing political work when invoked. In this sense, they operate akin to any other construction of a people or group that serves different distributional agendas, such as gender, race, and indigeneity. The difference, and this is the gap I hope to fill today, is that we might not fully be attuned to the various ways in which the Islamic is constructed, or the political work it does and how. Before we turn to the Islamic, let's look at two other examples to see how the underlying dynamic of my argument works. The examples I will use draw from both the Canadian and the American context. I offer the Canadian as a comparator for a few reasons. On the one hand, the Canadian example offers certain sites of commonality between the two countries that allow me to highlight aspects that are shared across the border. On the other hand, since the election, I am aware that Americans crashed the Canadian immigration website, thinking that Canada might be a liberal democratic paradise as compared to the extreme rhetoric around the Trump campaign administration. I offer the Canadian as comparator because I don't want to leave you thinking that the Islamic and the Muslim are invoked only in extreme conditions, such as face countries like the US, France, and the UK these days. So today I want to start with thinking about indigeneity. When I teach Canadian law as it relates to Canada's indigenous peoples, and this is perhaps to a certain degree analogous to the way we might think about it in the US, but as someone who grew up in Canada where Native Americans were not part of the day-to-day, one of the things I've encountered in Canada is the everyday ordinariness of thinking about indigeneity. And I want to bring that today to think about law. So when I teach Canadian law as it relates to Canada's indigenous peoples, I do so from two vantage points, statutory interpretation and constitutional law. But implicit in both disciplinary fields within the Canadian legal tradition, there are various moments when it becomes clear that as far as Canadian law is concerned, our indigenous communities do not have law. Or to put it paternalistically, they do not have real law. To understand how Canadian law signals this absence of law among indigenous peoples, in a sense, their lawlessness, let's step back to think about how we construct our own conceptions of legality in relationship to other traditions that we deem foreign. And to do this, I want to introduce you to a term, a phrase really, legal orientalism. Edward Said, in his 1979 book, Orientalism, took aim at the European construction of the Middle East and the Islamic. For anyone remotely informed about post-colonial literature, Said's work is a staple, though is also subject to various limitations. For our purposes here, I simply want to introduce the core idea of Orientalism to you. He offers a range of meanings of the term, but two are important here. Orientalism is a style of thought, he writes, based upon an ontological and epistemological distinction made between the Orient and most of the time the Occident. And rather than read the entire definition, which is interesting, the idea here is that there's an assumption that the difference is a matter of fact that we can take for granted. And the taken for grantedness of it allows what comes in at definition two. For definition two, which is my interest here, he writes, given this presumed factual difference between the East and the West, then Orientalism also is, taking the late 18th century as a very roughly defined starting point, Orientalism can be discussed and analyzed as the corporate institution for dealing with the Orient, dealing with it by making statements about it, authorizing views of it, describing it by teaching it, settling it. In short, Orientalism as a Western style for dominating, restructuring, and having authority over the Orient. Said's account of Orientalism was very much tied to the European representation or construction of the Middle East, taking as a starting point Napoleon's invasion of Egypt in the late 18th century. In what sense, though, might his Orientalism be helpful for us in thinking about Canadian law and its exclusion of other traditions as non-law? To this end, I want to introduce you to the work of Temu Raskola, an Emory Law School professor who's also a specialist of Chinese law. Raskola's book, Legal Orientalism, began as a book about law in China, but turned into a book about the US conception, imagination of law in China. In particular, Raskola was fascinated by how US accounts of China made it seem clear that China has no law. Of course, in the presumed absence of such law, American business interests worried about the risks they might suffer if they invested heavily in the Chinese market. In what seems like a startling move in retrospect, the US government created the US District Court of China, based in Shanghai, whose law was a mishmash of Ninth Circuit decisions, Alaskan law, and other law from different jurisdictions, some of which those jurisdictions had since repealed. Though the District Court of China was dissolved by the 1940s, its very existence reveals how we conceptualize our own legality, in part through an orientalizing paradigm by which we cast others as having either weak law or no law at all. Drawing on Edward Said, but applying it to the discourse of law, Ruskola introduces then the term of legal orientalism. He writes, "By the term legal orientalism, then, I refer on the most general level to a set of interlocking narratives about what is and is not law, and who are and are not its proper subjects. Legal orientalism, the book, is concerned with defining an other through its relationship to law." So how might this legal orientalism help us understand the dynamic between how we construe a group and how we construe the purpose of the state and who it's for? Let's look for a moment at the riveting idea of statutory interpretation. I say that with a lot of irony because no one thinks it's riveting except for me. So when I teach constitutional law, and I teach my students about the Royal Proclamation of 1763, which was proclaimed by King George III to officially claim British territory in North America, specifically in Canada. And among the various paragraphs were certain statements related to the relation between the king and his indigenous, and the indigenous peoples, the indigenous nations of Canada. And when we think of constitutional founding documents in Canada, this certainly begins the narrative of Canada's sovereign story. But the narrative makes the proclamation of a relationship between the British and indigenous peoples a one-way statement that privileges the sovereignty of one, the British, while flattening, if not erasing, the sovereignty of the other. However, a year later, various indigenous communities came to Fort Niagara to provide their response and thereby cement the treaty. Their response lay in the wampum at Niagara, depicted here, the idea of two peoples joined together, hand in hand. And the idea was, this is their symbolic representation of the treaty of equal respect and engagement. Moreover, at the law school where I teach, I do so in a room that has a replica of the two-row wampum belt hanging up on a wall. The belt signals the equal respect and sovereign claim of both Britain and the indigenous communities. In this representation, the blue represents the rivers on which their separate and distinct boats flow. The rivers are parallel, do not cross, but respect each other in the spirit of friendship and peace and respect, which are themselves represented by the three white sections on the belt. To what extent are these wampum belts law? This question has been the stuff of scholarly research, and I'm fortunate to have had the privilege of reading the work of colleagues from around Canada on this issue. But as someone who teaches statutory interpretation, I can't help but notice that the wampum belts speak through imagery and metaphor. But do we make room for this approach to law in what we consider Canadian law? The way law is made, articulated, and read relegates things like the wampum belt, and indeed anything that is not textual, as non-law, as artifacts more appropriate for museums rather than law libraries. Let's take a few examples of how we think about where we how we locate law. The U.S. Supreme Court, the late Antonin Scalia, Justice of the U.S. Supreme Court, wrote about his approach to statutory interpretation, an approach that he called textualism. He wrote, "A text should not be construed strictly, and it should not be construed leniently. It should be construed reasonably to contain all that it fairly means. Words do not have a limited range, of meaning, and no interpretation that goes beyond that range is permissible." Canada has its own approach, the Dreger rule, which states, "Today there is only one principle or approach, namely the words of an act are to be read in their entire context, in their grammatical and ordinary sense, harmoniously with the scheme of the act, the object of the act, and the intention of Parliament." Note how the focus on texts and words makes little room for thinking without a text, without words. The very understanding of law that predominates allows us in the legal academy, in the legal profession, on the judiciary, to articulate a relationship between the indigenous peoples of Canada and law, in large part by articulating wampum belts as not law at all, and by implication, of designating indigenous people as without law or lawless. Of course, this is one example, and it's a narrow example that focuses more on the corollary of my argument rather than the core thesis, namely the way we construe the Islamic and the Muslim is related to how we understand what the state is for and for whom. Again, we're in a period in where the Muslim and the Islamic seem to unduly inform public opinion these days. This group is not alone, however, in performing this function, of course. Transgendered people are in their own painful spotlight, especially these days, as the Trump administration reconsiders washroom regulations. In the US context, the last few years of police violence and brutality have painfully reminded us of how Black Americans and increasingly Latinos and Latinas have been construed so as to inform what the state is and who it is for. If we examine the history of America's attempt to form a welfare state, we run into the fact that by the 1960s and 1970s, one important reason for the reversal of the New Deal had very much to do with race, namely the refusal to redistribute resources through welfare programs if it meant supporting Black and Latino communities in the US. As Francis Fox Piven and Richard Cloward argue, race has been one of the enduring issues of American politics, implicated in most of the great conflicts which periodically convulsed the United States, and also singularly important in the formation of everyday political identities. The political structures associated with a limited welfare state can only be fully explained by taking account of the tortured impact of slavery and institutionalized racism on the construction of the American polity. But it would be a mistake, I argue, to examine the operation of race in relation to welfare politics in isolation. Rather, to appreciate the relationship between racial minorities and the state, it's important to examine welfare state policies in relation to penal policies of the state. Again, another block quote. I apologize for all the reading, but I've been fascinated by the work of this US historian, Julili Kohler Hausman of Cornell University, who remarks that who remarks on the last decades of the 20th century, welfare policy and criminal policy were principal sites where society negotiated the state's responsibility to poor and socially marginalized people. And these policies became central staging grounds for the post-1960s chapter in the long historical struggle over the terms of citizenship. Debates over welfare state programs for the poor, unfolded alongside struggles over the penal system. Despite the racial and social diversity of the population subject to penal and welfare administration, Americans typically imagine welfare and crime as problems emanating from the same places: low-income African-American and Latina urban communities. Keeping that account of welfare politics of the US in the backdrop, it's worth turning to Michelle Alexander's powerful The New Jim Crow. In her marvelous study, she canvasses search and seizure rules, the development of private prisons, the war on drugs, all with the aim of revealing how through facially neutral legislative and judicial language, the US carceral state has become, in some sense, the substitute for the welfare state, at least for a certain percentage of Black American males in the US today. To view the welfare state and the carceral state politics in the US alongside attention to race is meant to showcase how the shifting policies of the state fundamentally operate by reference to the construction of certain racial groups, and in particular the Black American community, as both citizen and subject. So how does all this bring us to the Muslim and the Islamic? My aim in this last part of my talk is to illuminate the ways in which the Muslim and the Islamic are construed by reference to age-old tropes that have been with us for some time now, and which operate today paradoxically to delineate the contours of citizenship, belonging, and entitlement in the modern state. So let's first take a look at something that's been with us for some time, but perhaps only subliminally, given its distance from us today. I present to you the recorded words of Pope Urban II, at the Council of Clermont in 1095, as he called for the First Crusade. "Of Holy Jerusalem, brethren, we dare not speak, for we are exceedingly afraid and ashamed to speak of it, this very city in which, as you all know, Christ himself suffered for us because our sins demanded it, has been reduced to the pollution of paganism, and, I say it to our disgrace, withdrawn from the service of God. Such is the heap of reproach upon us who have so much deserved it. Who now serves the Church of the Blessed Mary in the Valley of Jehoshaphat, in which church she herself was buried in body? But why do we pass over the Temple of Solomon, nay, of the Lord, in which the barbarous nations place their idols, contrary to law, human and divine? Why does this passage interest me? It's fascinating for its historical significance of signaling a European awareness of the Islamic as other. That otherness is framed by the reference to barbarous nations and the idea that the Muslims of Jerusalem practice something contrary to law. In other words, we are in the realm of the lawless once again. This text provides tropes about Islam that continue to inform our worldview. For instance, let's take a look at Canada's recent legislative activity. In 2015, Canada's conservative-led government introduced Bill S-7 to combat certain practices like forced marriage. The short title for the act, which was later passed into law, is Zero Tolerance for Barbaric Cultural Practices Act. The act amends the Immigration and Refugee Protection Act to exclude permanent residents and foreign nationals on grounds of practicing polygamy if they are or will be practicing polygamy with a person who is or will be physically present in Canada at the same time as the permanent resident or foreign national. To combat forced marriage, the act amends the Civil Marriage Act to require as a condition of a valid marriage the free and enlightened consent of two persons to be the spouse of each other. The phrase free and enlightened draws upon a French formulation, but in the context of the tropes about Islam, it implicitly evokes a 17th century European intellectual genealogy. Indeed, when we read this legislation alongside Pope Urban II's call for the First Crusade, it's hard to avoid seeing that despite the religiously neutral language of the act, that Muslims and Islam are the target. The use of barbaric in the title and the targeting of certain practices, which are cast as outside the law, even as non-law, but rather as merely cultural, make it hard to miss how this act seems to target an imagined Muslim who is full of culture and tradition, but not law. Indeed, the focus on the Muslim as both different and foreign is very much at the heart of this bill, despite the fact that these two practices informed the criminal prosecution of a fundamentalist LDS community in Bountiful, BC, a few years earlier. How do I know this bill was directed to the different and the foreign as opposed to the domestic? Because of which minister had carriage of the bill. It wasn't the Minister of Justice, it was Chris Alexander, who was at the time Minister of Immigration and Citizenship, Canada. For an American example of the interdependent relationship between the Islamic and the state, I'm never bored of the legislative theater that seeks to ban Sharia. There's some reference to it on the back of the one-page handout that you have. It's in these debates and others that we see an internal paradox about the Muslim. If before the Muslim was lawless, in debates on Sharia, the Muslim is little more than an automaton that can't help but adhere to a robust legal tradition. On this reading, Islam is full of law, or lawful. In an early version of its Sharia ban, which was subsequently amended extensively, Tennessee Senate Bill 1028 defines Sharia as follows. And I'm not going to read the whole thing there, but Sharia means a set of rules, precepts, instructions, or edicts, which are said to emanate directly or indirectly from the God of Allah or the Prophet Muhammad, and which include directly or indirectly the encouragement of any person to support the abrogation, destruction, or violation of the United States or Tennessee constitutions, or the destruction of the national existence of the United States or the sovereignty of this state, and which includes, among other methods to achieve these ends, the likely use of imminent force. The beginning is particularly interesting, the way Sharia is identified as rules, precepts, edicts, law in a sense. We certainly find law in Islam in this passage, but it's in the service of a public order that poses nothing less than an existential crisis for states in the US who seek to remain free, sovereign, and most importantly, democratic. Like Pope Urban II's barbarians whose polluting traditions laid waste to Jerusalem, so too does the possibility of Sharia threaten an entire way of life in states like Tennessee, in states like Oklahoma. Indeed, this perhaps explains why Oklahoma's constitutional amendment to ban Sharia was called, without irony, the Save Our State Amendment. More recently, we've seen President Trump of the United States issue an executive order that, by reference to statute, bans immigrants and refugees from seven Muslim-majority states, Iran, Iraq, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, Syria, Yemen. The internal paradox of the Muslim and the Islamic is most robustly on display in the very terms of the executive order, the paradox being Islam being lawless and lawful at the same time. The objective of the executive order is framed in terms of national security amid regions of instability where terrorist groups may operate freely and cross borders. So here's a passage from the purpose statements of the executive order. Deteriorating conditions in certain countries due to war, strife, disaster, and civil unrest increase the likelihood that terrorists will use any means possible to enter the United States. The United States must be vigilant during the visa issuance process to ensure that those approved for admission do not intend to harm Americans and that they have no ties to terrorism. In the next paragraph, in the same purpose statement of the executive order, it states, in order to protect Americans, the United States must ensure that those admitted to this country do not bear hostile attitudes toward it and its founding principles. The United States cannot and should not admit those who do not support the Constitution or those who would place violent ideologies over American law. In addition, the United States should not admit those who engage in acts of bigotry or hatred, including honor killings, other forms of violence against women, or the persecution of those who practice religions different from their own, or who would oppress Americans of any race, gender, or sexual orientation. Now, the executive order has been called a Muslim ban, though the Trump administration has rebuked that, suggesting no, rather, it's an exercise of presidential executive authority pursuant to his powers over national security and immigration. But this dispute about the characterization operates as if they are mutually exclusive. It's either a Muslim ban or it's a national security measure. But if we're to see the Muslim and the Islamic construed in the service of the state, I want to suggest we ought to recalibrate our analysis by suggesting how the executive order fashions a national security policy of the state by reference to concepts of the Islamic and the Muslim, ones that we've already seen. Certainly nothing in the executive order expressly states as much. And many instead have said, looking to Trump's tweets and campaign promises, they've said that's where we can identify the executive order is really about a Muslim ban. But I want to suggest that the text itself gives the Islamic away, that the Islamic is intimately intertwined in the very construction of the nation whose security is being sought and preserved. Trump's executive order situates the United States in an international system in which the principles of territorial sovereignty, jurisdiction, and border management have broken down in some cases. Countries like Somalia, Yemen, and Libya, which have suffered years of conflict, have limited institutional capacity to manage their domestic affairs, let alone their borders, oftentimes being deemed fragile or failing states. Into the vacuum of these underperforming Muslim-majority states, where now there is too little law due to the state's underperformance, we find Islamist groups such as Al-Shabaab in Somalia, Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, and ISIS in Iraq. With these groups in mind, with the Sharia that they bring that is also full of law, the executive order expresses concerns about domestic security by reference then to the lawlessness of Muslim-majority states who've lost control of their borders in an international setting in which border management makes the state system possible. It is not merely that the seven countries are Muslim-majority states that makes the executive order a Muslim ban. It is that they all have an absence of law and so fall within a trope of the Muslim as lawless and thereby a danger to other states who must now take measures to guard their borders. Hence why Saudi Arabia is not on the list, for instance. The order adopts, however, the other trope of lawfulness. The Islamic is full of law and the Muslim is automaton who simply complies in robotic fundamentalism. The executive order identifies disfavored practices in its purpose statements. This inclusion of belief and practices specifically the reference to violent ideologies, violence against women, and the persecution of minorities, serve as facially neutral proxies for Islam. For instance, the debate in some quarters about whether Islam is even a religion, or rather is it a way of life or a political ideology, reflects the concern that Islam is a totalizing tradition that, so full of law, stands in contrast to and seeks to supersede all other political ideologies, such as democracy and liberalism, and the regulations that make them possible. On this construction of the Islamic in relationship to these extremist groups who carry Sharia with them, proponents of democracy must be wary of creating space for the Islamic with its laws, its lawfulness, lest it erode the very fabric of a democratic public sphere. The link between the Islamic and its utter lawfulness is best expressed by the Center for Security Policy's 2010 report, Sharia, the Next Threat to America. In that report, the authors characterize Islam, and in particular Islamic law, as, quote, a totalitarian socio-political doctrine. Translated as the path, Sharia is a comprehensive legal and political framework. Though it certainly has spiritual elements, it would be a mistake to think of Sharia as a religious code in the Western sense, because it seeks to regulate all manner of behavior in the secular sphere, economic, social, military, legal, and political, end quote. Far from being contained, Sharia as a proxy for Islam writ large threatens to unravel the very fabric of liberal democratic orders such as the United States. Among the new threats the Islamic will push upon hapless Americans are the all too available legal rules encompassing patriarchy, as evidenced by rules on marriage, divorce, inheritance, and child custody, and religious intolerance, such as the so-called Dhimmi rules of pre-modern Islamic history that discriminated against religious minorities. The executive order's inclusion of these beliefs and acts speaks implicitly, and importantly in facially neutral terms, to a long-standing construction of the Islamic as supersessionist, as patriarchal, and intolerant of other religious beliefs. But the executive order's persuasive power lies in its employment of the two depictions of the Islamic and the Muslim as lawful and lawless, and in doing so reveals the paradox that fuels the political work of competing constructions of the Islamic and the Muslim. I realize I've kept you going for a while, and I want to bring this to a conclusion, but I have a last example that I really want to bring up, and so I'm going to ask your indulgence for a few minutes as I take you to the 9th century with another example, which I think will be fun, and we'll see. But if not, you can tell me later in the Q&A session if I should have ended early. But I want to conclude with a recent example from Canada that I think actually translates here as well. It invokes ideas that we also see coming out of the UK and France. And so in this sense, I want to use this example to suggest that these tropes about the Islamic have been and remain with us and don't need an extreme case like the Trump administration to nonetheless operate. The Canadian Parliament just a few weeks ago debated a motion. Motion 103, introduced by Liberal Member of Parliament Ikra Khalid, to condemn Islamophobia and commit to studying its impact in Canada. This was shortly after the massacre at the Quebec City Mosque. The motion does not create new law, but rather asks the government to condemn Islamophobia and all forms of systemic racism and religious discrimination. It directs the government to study how best to combat systemic racism, religious discrimination, and specifically mentions Islamophobia. In other words, this motion is a directive from Parliament to itself in order to inform how best to govern pursuant to a set of ends or goals. In other words, a state trying to determine what its goals are. It's a motion in the regular operation of the state function. What's been intriguing to me, though, is to see the opposition to the motion. There are a range of critiques that I can focus on, but of particular interest in the concern is the concern that the term Islamophobia in the motion is too broad, too vague, and potentially limits free speech and critique. In rising up to stand against the motion in Parliament, David Anderson claimed that there's no consensus on the meaning of the word, asking, quote, Is it so inclusive that it covers any and all criticism of Islam? End quote. This concern about the motion is an undercutting freedom of speech, as was rampant across the media. A conservative leadership candidate, Maxime Bernier, wrote on his Facebook account, "Is this motion a first step towards restricting our right to criticize Islam, given the international situation and the fact that jihadi terrorism is today the most important threat to our security? I think this is a serious concern we have to take into account." On the one hand, people might be worried about an anti-blasphemy provision, given what we know to be operating in countries such as Pakistan. But the idea that the fear here is about speech and critique, I want to suggest, has a longer history than we might realize. I want to suggest it takes us back to medieval European conceptions of the Islamic as they informed the work of missionaries. Christian missionaries in the Muslim world for centuries were both interested and concerned about converting Muslims to Christianity. But as they aimed to create a universal church, they believed that to convert Muslims posed particular challenges. First, they were of the view that Muslims generally refused to convert from Islam to another faith, let alone Christianity, though there were, in fact, examples of that. Nonetheless, as a historian of medieval Europe and the Crusades, Benjamin Kadar remarks, while most medieval Europeans knew little or nothing about Islam, quote, one facet of Islam must have been surprisingly well known, the absolute prohibition of attacks against the Muslim creed. This understanding of Islam and its prohibition against attacks on its creed, writes Kadar, may explain why there was little or no peaceful attempts at conversion in Muslim lands. He writes, the Catholic abstention from efforts to convert the Muslims resulted to a considerable extent from an awareness of the Muslim prohibition of attacks against their religion, attacks that were bound to be intrinsic to Catholic missionary efforts of that age. In other words, to proselytize Muslims to convert to Christianity, it was believed, posed inherent risks of violent reprisals. It stands to reason, therefore, that any attempt to proselytize successfully would need to be on the heels of military intervention in the region, such as the Crusades. One story that bears reflection concerns the so-called martyrs of Cordoba, who between the years 850 and 859 of the Common Era were said to have publicly proclaimed their Christianity in Muslim-ruled Spain and were executed for blaspheming the Prophet. Approximately 48 people met their death this way, according to the story told by Eulogius. Though the fiercely polemical nature of the writings has given some to pause at the veracity of his accounts. A few years ago, I was at a lecture in which one when I was in residence at Princeton, in which one scholar suggested that the entire story of the martyrs of Cordoba was made up. History, though, remembers the martyrs of Cordoba as truth tellers, speaking truth to power. Whether the story of the martyrs of Cordoba is made up or not, whether it's fake news or not, it certainly served as propaganda, leading to the conditions that made Pope Urban II's speech nearly 150 years later at the Council of Clermont both possible, meaningful, indeed commonsensical. So when we see today a debate in the House of Commons alleging that to oppose Islamophobia is to give up our commitment to free speech, it's hard not to hear the polemics of the 9th century Eulogius and the implications of that polemic for directing the use of the resources of the relevant regimes. For Eulogius, it may have been the Latin West he was seeking to ask for intervention under the sacerdotal authority of the church. Here in Canada, or there in Canada, it's about the Standing Committee on Canadian Heritage, one of the ministries of government, which the motion asks to undertake a study on how the government could develop a whole-of-government approach against systemic racism, religious discrimination, and Islamophobia. So let me conclude first by thanking you for being here today, taking the time to listen, and hopefully I've shared something that you found interesting. I've attempted to argue that the various invocations of the Islamic and the Muslim are often less reflective of anything objective associated with those terms, but rather serve as at times paradoxical constructs that do political work. In that sense, the public invocations of Islam and Muslims are analogous to the sorts of invocations we already know when we think about the political work done by reference to gender, sexuality, race, and indigeneity. What I've tried to emphasize is the political work done when Islam and Muslim are invoked, political work that takes shape in and through our law, in casting another people or a tradition as lawless or lawful, or both at the same time. Less frequently, that shape is given express form. More often, it operates through facially neutral language that correlates with a set of adverse consequences on certain communities rather than others. This sort of systemic work is made manifest through the operation of the state, or at the very least, through contests over how the state ought to operate and with what public in mind. In law school, we often leave students with the impression that the law is reasoned and rational. Our judicial-centric tendency in the common law, as reiterated through the pedagogy of the case method, puts law in the mouth of judges who reason to a conclusion and decision. But all too often, we fail to see how the boundaries of what counts as law come from a range of assumptions that go unstated in what we deem to be legally relevant and authoritative sources. As such, these assumptions operate coercively, not only in configuring state responses, but also in operationalizing those state responses on the bodies of those subject to the state's dominion. I've sought to articulate some of those assumptions as they pertain to the Islamic and the Muslim at a time when both are invoked around the world in the service of the state. No less here than in Saudi Arabia, the Islamic and the Muslim are concepts doing work to operationalize a state and make it serve those who are deemed its public. But in constituting that public in North America, these assumptions ultimately run the risk of fostering an exclusionary ethic within a democratic constitutional tradition. We see that exclusionary logic operate today on Muslims as it has operated on so many before and still does. The Jews here and abroad, the Black community in America, the indigenous peoples of Canada and the United States, women, the LGBTQ communities. The Muslim and the Islamic have informed a long-standing European intellectual heritage that is brought out when needed. It was there in the Crusades when Pope Urban II raised the threat of pollution, barbarity, and the absence of law. It was there in the 18th century during those constitutional conventions here in the US when delegates debated the inclusion of a religious test for the presidency and asked, hypothetically, whether a Muslim could be president. And it is here now again. My aim today has been a simple one, namely to ensure that our ears are attuned to understand what we are hearing when the Islamic and the Muslim are invoked in today's political culture. Thank you so very much.
It seems like when you're saying when people were defining, at least when Tennessee was defining what Sharia law is, I mean, it does seem, and this one of the comments actually said, well, it's not really all, just spiritual. I mean, it seems like that all of these laws should run afoul of the Establishment Clause if there's a religious basis, but are they trying to claim that this is law, not religion, as opposed to law overlapping with religion? Which seems like that should then, I would think people should be able to attack these laws as being against the Establishment Clause. And realize I'm not a lawyer, so you know what I mean? So I'm not like an expert in the Establishment Clause. But it just seems like that would be an easy target as long as there was enough overlap. But or I guess is the claim that these are totally separate.
Yeah. So that's a great question. What's interesting about a lot of these pieces of legislation, and this is where it gets technical, so I'm going to apologize in advance. Let's suppose, for example, that you have a contract in California, but one of the parties is in Nevada. And so the contract was formed in California, and it was supposed to be performed across the border, and you sue the contractual party that you contract, so you and the other party, you're going to sue for breach of contract in Nevada. Nevada has to decide, okay, well, I have personal jurisdiction over you because you're a Nevada resident, but what law should I apply? Do I apply Nevada's law of contracts, or do I apply California's law on contracts because the contract was formed there? It's what we call conflict of law. It's a simple conflict of law question. What's important about these Sharia ban legislations is more often than not, they were meant to articulate an amendment to a Judiciary Act. And as a Judiciary Act, it was about telling judges what they can and can't do in terms of what kind of foreign law they can or can't apply. In the context of our normal legal proceedings, it would be a kind of conflicts of law provision. So in that sense, these pieces of legislation were redundant to that. So there's already the Establishment Clause, right? But in an even more technical, more mundane, and really boring way, we already have conflicts of law provisions that deal with this. There's a case in Michigan, actually, of a woman who fell and got injured in a hotel in Saudi Arabia. The hotel chain was headquartered in Michigan, so she sued the hotel in Michigan, and the court had to decide, given that it's a tort action for an injury, which law applies, and the law says it's the law of the area, the land where you got injured. It's Saudi law. Wait a minute, but she is a non-Muslim woman getting injured. What kind of damages are there? Public policy considerations for the court in Michigan to say, technically it should be Saudi Arabian law, but that would violate our public policy. It's already there in the law. So if that's the case, then what are these rules doing? I want to suggest they're legislative theater. And you can tell they're legislative theater because of the redundancy, but also because you can tell that they're actually not that interesting by the end, because all these, the versions that I've shown you were the drafts. The final versions got completely cleansed of these kinds of languages around Sharia. And all they really did was rely on one draft bill by a gentleman named David Yarashami, who said that we will not apply foreign law if it doesn't uphold the same rights as those held in the United States. Well, again, redundant, uninteresting, but a pretext for what had really been legislative theater. So I take your point, like, well, what's the point of these laws? I agree. But the point is, in fact, the theater and the great politics it played. It's not surprising that most of these pieces of legislation, with the exception of the Oklahoma Amendment, which was a 2010 amendment, almost all were submitted in 2011 when the Republicans took state legislatures. And I don't think that's insignificant.
I think most people would agree that the state has a right to protect itself, protect its people. Mm-hmm. And the question is where to draw the line when the state's laws to protect everyone conflict with minorities or, say, one religion's laws, which conflict with the state. I think that, let's say, liberal Americans would probably today, many disagree with France's ban on the burqa as being saying this is unreasonable for the state to ban that, even though in France, some people believe that the burqa is a direct threat to what they consider the state. And yet, the same liberal Americans may say that the concept of honor killing, which may be permissible in some areas of the world, would indeed be a threat to the state here, so we should outlaw that. So the question is how there's I don't see how one can apply any kind of rule to assure that whatever laws we devise are fair or acceptable, because it's really in the eye of the beholder in terms of what the majority believes is indeed a threat to the state. And I wondered if you had any thoughts on that in terms of where we go with legislative drafting.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great question. So let's take a couple examples of where we already see in the case. I remember when Harold Coe, during the Obama administration, Harold Coe was appointed as legal advisor to Secretary Clinton as legal advisor, and he got into a lot of trouble because he was saying, well, Sharia is already at play in many American states. This is a silly debate that we're having. He got into trouble at a Senate confirmation hearing. And so let's think about what exactly the bills, on the one hand is what the bills try to do, but there's also the reality of legal practice. And so let's take a couple examples. A Muslim couple wants to get married. They have the civil legal system of the state of Maryland. So they'll file for a marriage license or whatever, and they'll file that with the state. There's a parallel informal system of, well, under Islamic law, you'll have a marriage contract where you'll offer, like the groom will offer marriage, the bride will accept, and there's an exchange, a bride price, if you want to call it, or a dowry called the mehr, which, well, it's called dowry for the purposes of this conversation. And What's interesting is the dowry is oftentimes symbolic, but sometimes it can be kind of ridiculous, like in these gestures of great love. There was a case of an Iranian in Westwood, an Iranian couple, and the husband promised as a mahar his wife's weight in bullion, right? Which is a lot, and I think she gained weight upon divorce for good reason, right? And under the technical legal rules, I can, let's say I'm the husband, I can pay a percentage of that amount, and the rest of it's due upon death or divorce, right? So is the mahar a lien on the estate upon divorce? If I'm in a community property state where the marital estate is supposed to be separated 50-50, that supports certain gender egalitarian notions about ensuring that we don't have women who devote their lives, let's say, to their families becoming wards in the state. So community property has a public policy orientation that sees the 50-50 split as important. So now the wife comes in and says, but wait a minute, I have this mahar of, let's say, $100,000. And that $100,000 has to be removed from the estate before the community property division. Do we allow that or not? Under Islamic law, it's a religious provision. So the court might say, this is a religious contract, and if we give legal effect to a religious contract, does it violate the Establishment Clause? Or in this case, is there a public policy consideration around gender equality? Or is it a prenuptial agreement? Is it a contract and a prenup? If it's a prenup, we've been there, we've done that. So the question then is, do we see the dowry as law, or do we see it as religion? And if we see it as law, it's a prenup. If we see it as religion, it's inapplicable. Or even if it's not inapplicable as a matter of our law, it's a violation of public policy considerations. In those cases, though, I think the law is capable of managing. In Canada, for instance, if you're in British Columbia, the British Columbia courts will see it as law. It's a contract provision, and they'll grant it. In Ontario, it's a religious provision. They won't grant it. In various states in the US, there's no agreement on that particular matter. So you can see how, in some sense, the question is, it's one of translation. When we think of honor crimes, and I remember when I moved to Canada, it was in the midst of the Ontario Sharia debate. Can Muslims arbitrate family divorce proceedings under Islamic law? And I remember getting questions like, well, what about stoning? Aren't we gonna see stoning? And I was like, well, wait a minute, I'm pretty sure Canada's not giving up its criminal law jurisdiction. But what I do think is that if you take honor crimes of any sort, and Canada has had its share to the point that my conversation with the Justice Department in Ottawa puts me in touch with the family law division, and this is one of their things, honor-based violence, HBV is what they call it. And it's a problem. There's no doubt as a cultural practice, it's a problem. But from a legal perspective, how is it any different than any other form of domestic violence? We might say that it's not distinctive in kind, but it is distinctive in our offense to it. So maybe honor-based violence, if it's proven that it's honor-motivated, might become an aggravating circumstance with respect to sentencing. But as a matter of creating a brand new crime on honor-based violence, does it really make any sense? Or does the attempt to create the law against honor-based violence actually serve to criminalize a community associated with that? And that's my concern with that, right? I think we have ways of doing and dealing with this, and I think the courts have done pretty decently on these without too much legislative interference, though I'm again, as a statutes guy, I like drafting. I'm a big fan of it, but I'm mindful that perhaps what we're seeing around these Sharia bans is a distrust of the judiciary, a location of our majoritarian democratic politics in the voice of the legislature, and in that sense, a desire by the legislature to shackle the judiciary from what it normally has been doing.
My question to you is, my favorite thing that you said was, if at the end of this talk you don't have more clarity, that's great. Yeah. And you said, we're gonna sit in stillness here together, right? In this sort of suspended moment.
Yeah.
And you're gonna deepen our understanding.
Yeah.
How in this particular moment do we champion sitting still?
Yeah.
And the gray area? We do, you know, I do public programming, and I'm hearing, this is just more talk. You know, we want action, We want decisiveness, and we want the black and white, because there's, so how do, and I truly believe as humanists that we dwell in the gray area. So how do we defend that gray area right now?
Yeah, no, I think that's a great question. And there are moments where I think maybe I'm not built to be in the gray area. part of my conversation today with the scholars at the ICJS is help me figure out how to do that, because it's not, I occupy the fairly rarefied, as I mentioned, I think I've said this now twice today, because I truly believe this. The law school that I teach at is a fairly rarefied environment. The public I deal with are some fairly overprivileged law students, frankly, who are well-meaning, but certainly let's put it that way. Lawyers, members of the judiciary, a fairly limited bunch. And so part of my challenge is now in thinking about what to do in this gray area. How do you sit still? I'm going to be really frank with you. I'm still struggling with that. I don't quite know. I know that after the election, after the inauguration, the first thing I did was I set up a Twitter account so that now I'm on Twitter. And then 2 weeks later, I stopped looking at my Twitter account, right? And I think that there's a sense in which I'm struggling with the fact that there is an overabundance of information, but there's little effort at trying to figure out what it means to develop knowledge. And my challenge now is to think about what are the kinds of filtering devices we can create to help people who are otherwise very busy, just trying to put food on the table, to think about not so much what do I know, but what filter am I using to figure out what I know? To question the filter. I don't think it's fair to say that Trump supporters are stupid or ignorant. I think they're busy. I think all of us are busy. I think all of us have to struggle in an environment of an information abundance, and there's an economy of knowledge that we have to participate in, because frankly, I'd rather spend time playing with my kids. I need to go and give this talk or go down and deal with urban traffic or whatnot or rural traffic. So the question for me is, and this again is perhaps, this is I think the obligation upon academics in the university, and so I don't know to what extent this translates across different sectors, but to me, the university and my colleagues, I'm pressing them to say, let's think about how we can assess the filters that people use to give them credible ways of figuring out how best to process where they're getting the information from, regardless of what they think they're getting, right? I'm okay with a democratic politics of difference, difference opinion, difference differences of ideas, but I want them to be based on something other than mere supposition or fear. How do we create those filters? And that to me is the goal right now. And what I'm hoping today is to say, well, one filter is to think about how is the Islamic used? Not so much what is the Islamic, where is Islamic law, what does it mean here in Saudi Arabia for Arkansas? Well, it doesn't mean anything necessarily because it's Saudi Arabian jurisdiction, but what it does mean is that I'm being made to be fearful of something that's quite foreign. And so this conception of the Islamic as foreign, as external, as threatening, that needs to be identified for the trope that it is and the political work it's doing. That to me is what I feel I can do. But I think everyone is doing something different. Every scholar I met today and everyone at the ICJS who I've met today, and I had a really amazing time today, is doing something in the way they know best and brings that ability, some of which I need to, and I said to them, I need to learn from you how better to do that. And so my hope is certainly in a short-term goal is to coordinate more with places like the ICJS that to me serves the important function of sitting between the university and sort of where the gray area meets the road in a sense and helping that translation process. So to me, I think the ICJS has been a really wonderful place to come and spend my day and maybe hopefully another day, another time, if they'll have me.
Again, like all the others, I want to thank you for such an informative presentation. What I particularly liked was the paradox, yeah. Because that's exactly yeah. what I've experienced when I'm talking to friends of mine. Yeah. So On one hand, I will have friends say something like, no, I understand we have to make this distinction between what people do and terrorists, et cetera. And then they will then say, but look at the religion. Yeah. First of all, it's not a religion.
Yes.
It's something else, and it's insane, and it's demonic, yeah. And it doesn't matter what the scholars say about it. So sitting still and hearing this conversation has been very helpful to me, because now I have a way of communicating about how we filter and enter into the conversation. The other part, as a Christian, St. Paul says that there's one body, many members, we all do different things.
Yeah.
And so, yes, some people are going to be extraordinarily proactive. Some people are going to deepen their understanding. And I think what you have helped me with this evening is where I fit in this body, is to sit still and do more learning. So thank you.
Thank you for that comment. That's very kind of you.
Good evening, and thank you, sir, very much, Dr. Emon. I'm wondering if, in a more active way, we can participate right here in Maryland by encouraging the legislatures and maybe encouraging the ACLU to start a real movement to be testing these bans in some of the other states by having someone bring it to the courts.
Yeah.
Because that's one way, I think, that people do listen when the court will rule on something. I mean, is there a movement toward that in the United States?
So it's interesting. I'm gonna stand back for a bit first and then sort of reflect on that and then speak to the movement part. What was interesting about the Ninth Circuit's decision, what also reveals the way in which the Islamic is informing how the state functions, is how the Trump administration was claiming that its executive order was rooted in the president's plenary prerogative power under immigration and national security law, and therefore was unreviewable by the court, right? It was pretty extreme, right? But there was a kind of absolutist claim in the interest of protecting the state, which goes back to your point that, well, the state ought to be able to do that. And in fact, it does, and it should, and you're absolutely right. So this is one way where we need to recognize that there's a commonsensicalness to the underlying claim, that we actually can't do without it to a certain degree. But what's interesting is that the way the Trump administration construed the Muslim in the service of this executive order was by casting it as foreign and threatening. But when the Ninth Circuit had to review the order, it recast the Muslim as a rights-bearing individual, which means that the Muslim as individual is not foreign and threatening, but is domestic and presumably domesticatable, right? And so not harmful. So in many ways, the courts play this function through a rights discourse that situates the executive function in contrast to the judicial. So you're right to suggest maybe the courts are the site for thinking hard and fast. And I have to say, shortly after the ban came into effect, I flew to Boston. And I was, I travel on an American passport. I'm a dual citizen, so I'm very fortunate I can move back and forth quite easily. But I was a little nervous coming across the border. What's going to happen? How am I going to be treated? And I was, but the Canadian border, no, that not the Canadian, the customs and border official said, oh, welcome back. I was like, well, actually, I live in Canada. I said, well, welcome back anyways. And so it was very nice. It's very nice. But I was immediately greeted as I left the customs area by a bunch of lawyers and law students who were at the terminal wanting to take a statement from me about what happened. I was immediately met by a group, and they were all from Boston University Law School. And so as I went and I said, I gotta meet your manager because I want to connect my students with you guys, turned out a buddy of mine from Yale was at the table managing the group. So it was kind of a fun reunion, right? But what it reminded me was, wow, lawyers are heroic. We're not just, you know, ambulance chasers. We're that too. But so all of that's to say, yes, I think that is certainly one approach. And I think it's an important one because it's all operating, these executive orders are, let's be frank, it's lawyers who are drafting the executive orders. It's members of the White House Office of Legal Counsel that are drafting them. So it has to be lawyers who are also fighting them. And I think that you're right to say groups like the ACLU need to be part of it. But I also take comfort in places like the Southern Poverty Law Center, whose data collection work is phenomenal. Their anti-racism work across sectors and across intersecting groups is astounding. I think groups like focusing on immigration and refugees are amazing, and it may not always need to be litigation that is the vehicle, right? Litigation is one vehicle, a costly vehicle, let's be frank, and not always the most effective or efficient, though here, thankfully, it was with respect to the ban. But I want to encourage people to think outside the box. You had said that there's different ways we all can be in this context, and I don't think there's any limitation to what's at stake, but I do think, yes, Maryland, Washington, Minnesota, these are states that have the ability through their offices of the Attorney General to take issue with the ban because of the way it affects their states, and on federalism grounds, as well as on equal protection and religious freedom grounds, to make claims. As the new version of the executive orders are rolled out and they're more carefully drafted, it's going to be harder and harder. It's going to be easier and easier to see courts. We're going to see courts probably give them a pass. And so at a certain point, we may exhaust what the legal remedies are as the White House becomes more careful and precise. So it's one approach, but I don't know if it can be the whole.
I'm wondering, I was just reading about that there are some people that the term Islamophobia, they disagree with that and they think it should be anti-Muslim because it's not against the religion as much as against the people, and I was wondering what you think about that.
I think that's a great question. It's certainly one of the critiques of M103 in Canada. And, you know, what's interesting about Islamophobia is that it suffers the same critiques as the term homophobia, that it renders the what might very well be a systemic feature in terms of fear, and so it pathologizes something, which might not be a fair maneuver. Like homophobia, it tends to code masculine as opposed to inclusive of the feminine, and so lesbians I know wouldn't use homophobia to be lesbophobia, for instance. There's others who would say that there's also a racial element as well, and so does homophobia, is it inclusive of the LGBT community that's also racially coded as well, it's racialized. So there's ways in which Islamophobia, I think, is a problematic term, and there's no doubt about it. But what's also interesting is that if we think about shifting the focus to Muslim, anti-Muslim harm or harm to Muslims individually, We also end up perhaps missing the systemic picture, and that would be my concern. Not because I think Islamophobia necessarily captures the systemic either, but to the extent the idea is that there are systemic features in our intellectual heritage that cast the Islamic and the Muslim together in tropes like the barbaric, like the lawful, like the lawless, simply capturing the idea of anti-Muslim or being anti-Muslim reduces the harm to an individuated atomistic sensibility that's very consistent with our liberal terms around rights and equality, but maybe also individualizes the harm as opposed to seeing it as an aggregated instantiation of something more broad, much more systemic, that isn't about intent, right? It's not about the intent. I'm less concerned about the person who intentionally insults me as a Muslim. I'm more concerned about the person who hates Muslims or doesn't like Muslims, but uses neutral language to cast a general rule that actually adversely impacts the Muslim community. So I want to first know, in terms of the critique of Islamophobia, if it if the critique comes with a both systemic and individuated orientation to the harm. And that would be my only concern. Thank you for the question, though. It's a great question.
Within the world of Sharia law, yeah, is there a mechanism for Sharia law to develop?
Yes, so that's a great question. So this idea of developing Islamic law is an interesting one. On the one hand, I want to say yes and no. Not because of internal problems, but because of certain political realities. So historically, I would say that Muslim jurists debated whether or not they could develop new law. I have a book called Islamic Natural Law Theories, which is all about reason as a source of law. And to what extent can reason inform the law, can inform what can be legal outcomes that we reason and then attribute to the divine will. And that's one way of thinking about the development of law. There's other ways in which we might think of legal change, like can the law change with time and place, customary changes, and just the movement in history. And we have a long sort of, and if this were a course on Islamic legal theory, I'd be delighted and I would bore you ad nauseum with statements from the 12th century and 11th and 10th and maybe 14th, but I'm not sure after the 15th because that's too young for me. So I'd bore you to death with that. But what's interesting about today is that the notion of the Sharia in the Muslim world operates both informally and formally. And that in part also creates the conditions for how much it can move. So at least this is one way of thinking about it, is that informally it might inform different ethics, different ideas, different kinds of ritual purification practices, how people pray, how they interact with one another. But it's also implemented by the state in statutory form in what are called personal status laws, which are specifically about marriage, divorce, inheritance, and child custody. These are the remaining sites of Islamic law. So what's interesting is when we talk about Islamic law developing, it was already, in a sense, cut off from developing the moment the imperial enterprise, whether it's British or French, began supplanting French law for Islamic law. So for instance, when the French were in Algeria, they took out Islamic property law and just put in the French law of obligations. And in many ways, that has remained the case. You go to Egypt, it's based on the French Civil Code. Morocco, based on the French Civil Code. So what it means then to develop Islamic law is, well, really, are we able to see development in the area of family law? And because the state in the Muslim world comes out of this inheritance of both the colonial enterprise and the reduction of the Islamic law scope of law to begin with, family law becomes the site of Islam, not just only legally, but politically. To the extent that the state, let's say like Tunisia, claims to be an Islamic secular state or Islamic state because of a Nahda, for instance, they will see the personal status code as almost quasi-constitutional. The personal status law is the enshrinement of the Islamic identity of the state. So to tinker with family law, let's say in Dubai, is to tinker with an index of the state's legitimate claim to be Islamic. So it's a challenge because now that states have the monopoly over the law, they're also using religion. They're using Islam no less than Trump is using Islam to bolster the legitimacy of the state. And for as long as that remains in place, the ability to maneuver within the narrow confines of Islamic family law is somewhat limited. I say this, though, in contrast to other areas of law. So earlier I had mentioned how I'm hoping to audit classes now going into next year's academic year in securities regulation, which sounds really boring, and I think it probably will be. But I'm interested in the fact that Islamic finance is huge. In Malaysia, they've estimated that there's an $11.1 trillion market that has yet been untapped. Well, who's assessing that? It's a bunch of Muslim businessmen with a lot of capital who want to create entrepreneurial opportunities who construe the Muslim by reference to the law. if Sharia is so full of law that the Muslims can't help but follow it, well, that's exactly what venture capitalists want to think in suggesting there's an untapped Muslim market. Because Muslims, with their liquid assets, will of course want to invest them in a Sharia-compliant way. Even though I, for instance, have a mortgage at 4.5% or 3.5%. I have a very conventional mortgage, and so I'm not going to pay the added faith tax that comes with the Sharia-compliant mortgage. I'm too much of a rational actor that way, or I'm just cheap, I suppose. But the point is that when it comes to Islamic finance, it's amazing how much flexibility there is. So much so, as I mentioned earlier, that there is 110-acre space in Dubai, the city of Dubai. 110 acres have been designated as a special jurisdiction where you can engage in foreign investment in real estate, securities, and other forms of securitized exchanges, bonds or whatnot, where the governing law is UK law for those specific subject matters. Why? Because they know the international investment community both trusts and respects the UK and US law out of New York specifically. And if, as long as it's UK law, Dubai can and has indeed become the financial capital for the region. So why is it flexible with capital but not gender? Well, I'll come back for another Manekin-Clark lecture for that.
Thank you, sir, for very informative information. It's really beautiful. I want to say, go back to first thing that you talked about, the texting. I think part of the information or misinformation for the Americans is misunderstanding of what we're talking about. And that's why it's being used as a theater, like you said. So what is Sharia? If we ask an average American, you would have no idea where to start. So easy if you put, instead of filter, outlet of information. Yeah. Start from academic side, like from your side, and down to easy understanding explanation, a simple way. Yeah. I think it's ignorance more than misinformation, and that's how you can fight the misunderstanding of what is the Muslim law? Yeah. Why are you using this as part of, like you said, instead of one person, an anti-Muslim guy, it's anti-Muslim nation, or so the whole law. So it's information and the text itself, what it means, in a simple way. It definitely starts from an academic way and goes all the way into the simple way. And thank you again.
I appreciate that, thank you. So I'm of two minds about that. I mean, I'll be honest with you, when I went to Canada in 2005 and there was this big Sharia debate, I like you, was like, wow, people really don't get Sharia. They don't understand it. And so I wrote a couple op-eds, and I wrote a couple things, and suddenly, I arrived in July, on July 11th, 2005. Within 2 weeks, I hadn't said a word. I was still unpacking boxes, and there was a conference on the Sharia debate where opponents of it proclaimed after the law school had issued a press release that I had arrived, that the first Sharia law professor had arrived, at this conference it was declared that now the university agent of fundamentalist patriarchy had come to town. And I was like, wow, who's that guy? Oh, it's me. Ew. So apparently I was that guy. And then I did write in the context of that. But as I kept writing and trying to say, well, that's not what Sharia is, this is what Sharia is, I realized that it almost didn't matter at a certain point, because for Muslims and non-Muslims on both sides of the debate, the issue wasn't so much what is Sharia, the issue was something else. The issue was an experience they had in Iran or in Saudi Arabia or in Pakistan. And it was about not being able to understand what does it mean to think about this in Canada. It was always about an imposition of the foreign as if it would take over the domestic. And that's what was intriguing to me. It's like, well, why, where does that worry come from? And no amount of teaching about, well, no, it means this, not that. No, we're not going to give up criminal law jurisdiction, so don't worry about stoning. And if you need any word, there's a lot of rules about it. They didn't care about rules of evidence. They didn't care about rules of witnessing. there was an overall palpable fear. And to me, the only real way of thinking about it with people proactively, and here, you know, speaking to members of the judiciary, members of the Ontario Bar, and even I had the privilege of speaking to the Attorney General for Ontario, and I was like, this is not a religious freedom issue. This is an administrative law problem. And this is a problem about how do you administer an ADR, an alternative dispute resolution process, with the possibility of judicial review. And what does judicial review look like? How thick or thin is the standard? The thicker the review process, if you have an arbitration on Sharia grounds, and one of the parties says, well, that violates the Constitution of Canada, I'm gonna sue. And I go to court, and a judge sees an arbitral decision, on what basis does he review the rightness or the wrongness of it, the reasonability of it or the unreasonability of it? Does she say, well, I have a robust Canadian notion of equality, and so I will relegate this as invalid? Well, that's a very thick notion of the nation imposed upon the minority. Do I say, I'm gonna use a thin notion of review to enable communities to negotiate their orthodoxy? Well, that's multiculturalism run amok. Diversity is a harm. But the moment you pitch it at that level is when you begin to realize that the fight is not about what is Sharia. The fight is, do you as a democratic society want to take in and include the messiness, the very visible messiness of a community struggling to find its place in society? Because let's not pretend that Islamic arbitrations of any sort would be anything but messy. Of course they'd be messy. The news accounts were replete with stories that were horrific, but they're also replete with stories that weren't. And how do you negotiate that? My argument at the end was, fine, you've banned religious arbitration, and like abortions, they'll just go in the back alley. And in that sense, you, democratic society, can wipe your hands clean. But let's not pretend you've upheld an inclusive space. Let's not pretend that. You have created an exclusive democratic society, an exclusionary one, and in doing so, there's a cost to your democratic space. And that, to me, is really where I think the work has to be. It's not that you're wrong, and I'm not saying I'm not committed to educating. I'm committed to talking about what Islamic law is, but I'm much more careful about where I have those conversations. It's one thing when the government of Canada asks me, can you help me understand why Muslim states don't join the Convention on International Child Abduction? And sure, I'll help them do that. And we can have those conversations with judicial figures from the Saudi judiciary and from The Hague. But I don't know if that's where I need to go with the broader populace. Is that responsive?
Thank you very much. I know there were still a few more hands up, but we are out of time. So I want to thank you again.
It's my pleasure. Thank you all for being on here.